And without further ado, please welcome Horacio González and Aurélie Vache.
Thank you. Wow.
Awesome.
What a beautiful room. It is nice to be here after 3 years. Hey, Aurélie, wait. Let's do a nice selfie with all those people.
Oh, yes, sure.
So,
got it.
We are the talk between you and lunch. Let's try to make it easy, make it interactive, make it funny.
Yeah.
Let's begin. Let's talk about creating a Terraform provider. But before, let's introduce ourselves. Aurélie?
My name is Aurélie Vache. I'm a DevRel at OVH Cloud. I'm a GD. It's a Google developer expert on cloud technology. I'm a Docker captain, CNCF ambassador, and I'm a very invested in Women in Tech Association. I'm a tech article writer, and I love gophers.
Oh, that's important, yeah. We will see later.
Very, very important. And you?
I am Horacio González. I am a Spaniard who has been living in France for over 20 years, so my accent combines the worst traits of both Spanish and French accent.
Sorry about that, people. Really sorry.
I am the head of the developer relations team at OVH Cloud, and I am also rather involved in communities. Well, OVH Cloud, I hope you know us. If you don't, we have a booth just outside, and we are a global cloud provider. We are smaller than our friends from the Silicon Valley, but we are in the top 10 in the world, and we have a wide catalog of products. So please, next time you need to deploy an application, go look at our website. I think you will be impressed. But we are here to talk about...
Gophers?
No, I thought we were here to talk about Terraform.
With gophers.
OK, with gophers. You will understand why there are gophers everywhere in this talk.
Yes.
Let's begin. Terraform. Well, I guess we are at DevOps Barcelona. I guess everybody here has heard of Terraform. But let's introduce it. Terraform is a tool of infrastructure as code. Well, maybe you know the metaphor of pets versus cattle. I am old. When I began IT at the university, we had 4 servers that we call Fire, Ice, Earth, and another one, I think. And when the server was down, everybody worked to repair it, to reinstall it. When an update was needed, you go server by server, SSH, Horacio at Fire, apt update, apt upgrade. We took care of them. They had a name. They were like little puppies, like dogs. Right now, I have, for my side project, some 12, 14 instances. They have only an ID. I have never connected via SSH to them. They are like cattle. If one of the servers doesn't work well, I kill the instance. I spawn a new one. Cattle versus pet. And in order to do that, you cannot manage those servers individually. You need some kind of scripting, some kind of tooling. That's what we call infrastructure as code. We don't manage infrastructure individually. We manage using code. It has evolved a lot from the early tools that were basically a collection of scripts that imperatively run the commands. Right now, we have tools that are mostly declarative or even environment aware. So if this talk was done 10 years ago, I would have told you, Chef, Puppet, there are wonderful tools. They are great to manage your infrastructure. And it was true 10 years ago. 5 years ago, I would have some talk about Ansible. Hey, Ansible, it is great. You can manage your infrastructure. Today, the standard de facto is Terraform. Why? Because it's a highly evolved tool that makes easy to manage infrastructure, but not only infrastructure. That is one of the main points of our talk.
Yes, sure.
So, what is Terraform, Aurélie?
So, Terraform is a tool that allows you to build, modify, and version your infrastructure. It's a tool that allows to provision immutable infrastructure.
Immutable infrastructure? What do you mean by that?
That means that you can execute several times a Terraform file, and the result will always be the same.
Okay.
It's cool.
Nice. But we are talking about Terraform providers. What that?
Yes, Terraform is based on a modulable and extensible architecture. So, with a configuration file, you can call several providers that will call a client library and that call an upstream API.
And that's the key part of that. At the end, there is an API. Terraform, by creating a provider and a Go client, allows you to automate in API. There is also another concept in the extensibility of Terraform. There are modules. But yesterday, you have a super talk on
yes.
Terraform modules by Anton.
By Anton.
So
yeah.
Please, you ask him if you want to know that about, more about that part.
Sure.
And the Terraform registry, well, it is a registry where you can register, you can publish your providers and your modules.
And for this little story, when I start to use Terraform long time ago,
oh, yeah.
long time ago, there were only 100 provider.
And today there are
now,
more than
yes.
2,500. Yeah.
So
the ecosystem
good.
Has
yes.
really gone big.
Yes, it's very good.
So, how can you write your own Terraform provider? And behind that, there is another big question that we hope to answer. Why would you like to write your own Terraform provider? Let's go.
A provider is based on a plugin and SDK. So when you create a provider, you have to import Terraform plugin SDK.
The SDK, the version 2 of the SDK is done in Go, and providers by default are created in Go. It could be created in other languages, but it is strongly decouraged by
yes.
the AsheCore people. So, how can you install your provider? Well, the first way is the most simple. You install it from the register.
Yes.
But maybe you have some private provider, or maybe you want to test your provider before putting it in the registry. Then you can do a local install.
Yes. So you just have to build a provider and install it locally.
From the registry, it is simple. In your Terraform file, you are going to declare the namespace of the provider and then the name of the provider. So we have the namespace, and the source is the namespace slash my provider, and we are going to install that provider.
And it's really important to define the namespace and the provider which is in the registry, yes.
But what about locally? Well, locally, you need to build your provider, and then you need to put them in the local registry in your computer. For example, on a Mac M1, you are going to put it in the Terraform local, the name of the provider, the version, and the architecture.
Yes.
And when you have the provider then, you can install it with your Terraform file. And then Terraform local And you respect the same folder you defined it before.
Yes. It's very important to respect the path you define in your user local plugin directory.
OK, so installing a provider, it proves not so difficult. But the question, the big question is, why? Why
do I need? I have a question for you. I don't have any infrastructure application, so do I need one?
Well, do you have an API?
Sure, yes.
Then the answer is you can have a Terraform provider, and I am almost sure it can be really useful. Yeah. The idea is when we talk about Terraform, we think about instances, servers, Kubernetes clusters, whatever. But in fact, as we told before, you can use it to automate almost any API. That means, for example, that if your company is making a software as a service and there is an API, it could be a nice idea to build a Terraform provider around your API to allow your users to manage your software as a service like they manage all the other parts of the IT systems. It is a way for anyone producing an API to integrate the API in the global automation system of their customers. If you already have an API, it is because you are expecting your users to do all the tooling, calling the API and integrating that API in their tooling. But most customers today, they want to automate. They don't want to be writing API calls, doing curl, doing some fetch of your API in their tooling in order to integrate you. If you give them a provider, they can simply create a Terraform file and manage your product. So yeah, you have an API.
Yes.
You should try to write a provider.
Cool. So let's create it.
Step by step, of course.
As always. So what do you want?
Well, we love gophers. And
yes,
providers are written in Go, so it makes sense we are going to handle gophers. It is a silly API because we want to show you that even for a silly API, you can easily create a provider to manage it.
And we will follow the gopher recipe.
So we are going to create a very simple provider. And everything begins with an API.
Everything
can you tell us about your API, Aurélie?
I created a simple and very useful API that handles very cute gophers. And we can create it, delete, update it, and list all the existing gophers.
And a cute API on gophers. I like that.
OK.
As you see, there is a GitHub repository for the API, for the frontend, and for the provider. At the end of the talk, we will tweet the address of the presentation, so you will be able to recover all that. Let's go. Ah, yeah, we are going to live code a bit.
So we are in the GitHub repository, and we will like one tool. So,
in order to in order to do all the demos, we are going to use a super tool called Gitpod. If you don't know Gitpod, it's an automated developer environment in the web. There is a software as a service version, but it is fully open source. You can install it, and it has really changed the way we do demos, workshop, and everything like that. It is really a super tool,
yeah,
and we love it. So we can open the API directly in Gitpod.
Okay.
Let's go.
So I open it.
As you can see in the GitHub repository, we have a button opening Gitpod, and we arrive there. A Visual Studio Code readable, fully on the web, and we can
launch the API. Can you kill it and relaunch again in order to show them? It is a really simple API.
So first of all, I will run the API with simply task run. Task, oh, yes. So I love to use task file. Is like make files, but in Go, and you just have to define all the tasks in a YAML file.
So as you can see, we are generating our API from a Swagger file. Maybe we can show it to show the API.
The Swagger file is just here.
It
just
there is a health check, and there is a gophers get to this get the list of gophers, and a gopher.
Add a new gopher.
Post, put, delete,
and
so get.
Put, delete.
A rather simple API to get gophers. And each gopher is going to have a name, a display name, and an address for the image file.
Let's execute to get.
Right now, we only have one gopher.
Yes. And
yeah, but it is silly to only see a text. I want to see some drawings. Can we talk about the front end?
Yes. So before that, we can also take a look at the Swagger file. So
okay.
I run it. It's so let's go back here. So the new port is 4.5.
Don't forget the new URL. Copy directly. Copy directly the full URL from Gitpod. Go to the ports part.
Yes, I will copy pass there if I can or not.
We will show the Swagger file later. As you can say, it is the same version we have.
Not a problem. Up. So, yes, you have the Swagger file. And we can also show a website.
Yeah.
Time out.
Open the workspace.
So we open
for the front
again.
End. The front end is a very simple web application that calls the API every 5 seconds and shows the drawing of the gophers in the in the API.
Quickly. Yes, yes.
So we are starting from the GitHub repository.
And we will see, make public, obviously.
A port, go grab the new URL.
Is it the same?
No, it got changed, I think,
the
like
same
before.
Same URL?
Okay, no. You need to say to you need to set up your backend.
So is this so I've got the URL. So I copy past it.
Put that into the front end let's begin to monitor your API. Like that we will be able to play.
And we will copy past obviously the new URL.
/demo.
With /demo. Up. I love the demo effect.
Yeah, I really like that.
I love the demo effect. I love it. Oh, it's strange. So we have a demo.
Let me 2 seconds while begin to talk about providers.
Yes, yes, yes. I think it's a trouble in Gitpod.
Let me 2 seconds.
Yes, yes, yes.
It is working. Your API.
Yes, yes. Oh, yes. OK, so we have some trouble with this.
No, this one is working.
Yes. So we have the problem with the Wi-Fi. Yes.
No, it is only the Wi-Fi is extremely slow. OK, we are there. You can begin. We can begin with the next one. Let's add some other gopher to the API, and we can begin with the provider.
So we have a WinFile. And we call, and we can curl gophers, and curl a gopher enough in front, and add a new gopher. I want to add a new one. So I just execute the command, and the
you have copy
the Wi-Fi is so long.
Wi-Fi is really slow, so maybe I am going to open my 4G. Having a demo fully in the net with live coding without internet is going to be a bit sad.
So, yes. I don't know who is using it, but so long. Oh, so can I add one? Okay.
Give me
add a new gopher. Oh, yes. Better. Add a new gopher.
It is sad. Okay.
I will test.
We have it, and the front end,
in the front end,
it is going to see it. Yeah, we have it.
Obviously. Okay. So now, Wi-Fi. Yeah, Wi-Fi.
Normally, it should have taken 15 seconds. It has taken several minutes. Thank you, the Wi-Fi.
Yes.
But we can continue. Can we?
Gitpod. So now, we will try to add a new one. And it should be working. So if you see...
We have three.
And yes, okay.
We have three. Great.
Wait for one. Okay. And we can also delete a new one. Or just
update it. Let's go.
Okay. Update it and take a look. El mejor.
Sí.
Okay, it's working. Good? It's good. Okay, it's good. We execute some comments.
It is not possible. We want some network, please. Thanks.
Swagger save. Task
run. Gopher.
Delete put.
Hey, okay,
and
everything is good.
The front end. Okay. So let's create right now, if you can, a provider. So when I start to create a new provider, I didn't know how to start and where to start. So I found a Terraform provider. Scaffolding is just a template in GitHub that you can use in order to generate some skeleton code. So Terraform provider and my provider. Okay, public. Okay, let's create a new repository.
It is a template repository that allows you to generate a copy, not a fork, but a separate copy of the repository with the skeleton of the provider.
And now I will try to clone the new Terraform provider, my provider GitHub repository. Okay, I got it. And then we will take a look quickly on our ID. So we have our new provider, it's cool. But before that, so we create it, we demo it. So before to code, to add a new code, it's really important to execute to edit our makefile.
So the first step is you take the skeleton and you define the task you are going to need to create your provider. For most use cases, the tasks are really simple. You want to build, you want to create a release, you want to install it, to locally install it, and you want to launch the test, because there is a whole test suite for the providers you create.
Yes.
You modify your makefile by adding
the tasks, and then you are ready to begin to code.
I will say yes. So we edited it, okay? It's good. And what is the next step? Is to customize the provider definition. So
that means we are going to add a schema to our provider to explain what attributes we need, what attributes we need to expose. Our API is really simple. The only thing we need to expose to configure the provider is the endpoint, the address.
Yes, the address.
So
we add it there. And in the example, we will execute.
Maybe you can add the good one. It's the last one? We have so many examples.
I don't know if it's a good one, but I will copy paste.
This one. Okay, so we give it the endpoint of our API to the example file.
It's good right now.
Okay,
so
let's go.
Provider. Okay.
What the next?
It's good. It's to add a new data source name. Coffers. We want to list all Qt coffers. So let's do it.
So data source is the way to request the information of the current state of the provider. So the provider is going to need what information from the API? It's going to need the list of gophers. It's going to need to be able to ask for the details of one gopher. I need two data sources.
So one data source for all the gophers and one in order to display only information about one gopher. So we define two new data sources in the map.
Before going into the code, you are going to see there are a lot of plumbing code. There are a lot to code to making the API call to recover the JSON, to marshal the JSON into Go structs and all that. It isn't difficult. It is complicated. You need to write many plumbing code.
Yes.
And that's one of the problems of creating a provider. You see, oh, there are too many lines of code to write. Yeah, but they are always the same. I call the API, I get the data,
yes.
I put the data into Go structures, and I put that into the schema I have defined.
So in the code, we defined the gophers list with name, display name, and URL, the same schema as
in the API.
The API. The same. It's really important. And we define a read function. So we initiate a client. We call a get request. We retrieve the body. We decode it. And we add it in the coffers field that you defined, and we always set an ID.
To be fully honest,
yes.
I guess that in an ideal world, all that could be generated from the Swagger API. It is not really added value code, but it is always the same, copy, paste, modify. There is no real difficulty, there is complexity.
And
same thing for the other one?
Yes. So we define another one, so with a new schema, but it's the same, but with only one coffer, so only a name, display name, and a URL.
And then same thing, we and call, we recover.
Same thing.
Okay, so we have the data sources. What's next?
Test it.
Test it? Okay, why not?
We will test it. So, we have defined a lot of examples. So, let's take a look about it. I know. So first, we define a provider definition.
The sample definition we have seen before with the current URL of the API.
Yes. And we define a data sources definition. So we want to retrieve all the existing graphs. And we want a Terraform output that will return a boolean, true or false, if there is some existing graph. And we want to display all the information about one.
Let's go.
So obviously, we run a make install command every time you edit the provider. A little, yes, it's more. And then we need to remove dependency lock every time you edit the code and initiate the Terraform. OK?
OK, we are there. We have the new provider.
Let's apply it. Let's apply it. OK, up, apply. So, OK, we want to create our service. Oh, come on. Yes, I need to just to move the resources because we will see it in a few seconds. So we want only create two data sources.
Yes.
Yes, I want to. We have the output, and I really love one of the command that it's not known. It's Terraform show. We list everything you have in the Terraform state.
So as you can see, it has seen the data source. It has recovered the full list of three gophers.
Three gophers, yes.
Then it has asked for the detail of the five element gopher. And you have the detail. And the output, it is
cool.
True.
It's cool.
We have a working data source.
And now?
Now we need to be able to create, delete, and modify gophers.
OK. So we define in the provider a new resource in the map here.
We have the data source. Now we define a resource. The resource is a gopher.
Yes. So it's a resource with create, read, update,
it's and delete. It's a CRUD, a sample CRUD as our API.
Yes.
And it is the same thing that before. We create a schema.
A schema, yes.
Yeah.
Always.
And then?
And a struct. Oh, yes. And a struct.
Hey, what's that?
Yes, yes, yes. Just a misclick. So we define a create function. We retrieve all the field we define in the Terraform file. We decode it in a struct file, and we call a post command. And if all the things are successfully, we create it. Okay, so it's good for me.
So we do the same thing for read, for update, and for delete.
The same thing. We read. Okay?
It is only a wrap around the API.
Yeah, yeah.
A wrap in Go around the API.
And we did the same thing for update. It's the same code for post, but instead of doing a post, we did a put.
OK, yes. Let's go. Sorry. Let's test that.
And a delete function.
Yeah.
OK, so let's test it.
Yeah. Okay.
So I can right now
your resource.
Yes, I move it. So here, I will apply all my Terraform files. So we already
have data. As you can see, in the resource, we want to create a new Gopher.
Yeah.
We want to create an X files Gopher.
Yeah. The truth is here.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's create it. So creating a new Gopher. Oh, I will take a look if it's in my state.
So now in our front end, we should see it.
Drum roll.
Ah, yeah, it is there.
Okay, it's working. So we create it, okay? And if we want...
The first one has no image. Can you delete it?
Can I delete it? Yeah, but through a curl command. But if we execute Terraform destroy...
On the resource we have?
Only,
on the X-file resource? Okay.
Only it. So let's delete the X-file gopher, this one.
So now it means that if we go back, there is no more X-files.
If the API is here, destroying...
No, error deleted.
Ah, yes.
Once again, a small problem.
Yeah. It's git pod, yes. Awesome. I want it, but Gitpod...
Destroy it.
Okay.
Now.
Destroy it. So now...
We had a timeout before.
Yeah. And 1 second, two,
if we had network
three,
problem, maybe it would need
four,
to do a
five,
manual reset.
Yeah. I think we had the same trouble.
We have still a network problem, but if we are lucky, only three of them.
It's
wonderful.
Working.
Thank you.
So, we created data sources, resources, and now,
You have already seen, we have created,
the
data source,
the
resource with the CRUD. We have
tested it,
Okay, it works.
Stop.
It was a silly example. It is not the only provider we have created, because using the same kind of technique, we have created a provider from OVS Cloud products. The idea is we are a cloud provider who has built a public cloud based on OpenStack. Terraform has already a provider on OpenStack, so it could be enough, but we have built added value services over OpenStack and managed Kubernetes, databases as a service, an artificial intelligence suite. So we wanted our customers to be able to pilot not only the instances and the storage, but also the Kubernetes, the artificial intelligence, the databases. What we decided to do, to create a provider.
Yeah. And this provider is in the official registry, and we have a lot of internal and external contributors. So if you want, you can contribute too.
And the problem is, we weren't talking about one API, but about many different API for many different products. And then the complexity isn't writing the code to make the provider work. There are many other things, and that's the part we would like to talk about best practices. What to do and what not to do in order to write a provider, and to write a provider that you are able to maintain after that. And the first one is your favorite, I think. Documentation.
Documentation. It's really important to create it, to maintain it, and to have a up-to-date documentation. And thanks to the ecosystem, We have a tool, it's TF plugin docs that allow you to generate a documentation based on the schema you defined.
This is especially important in Terraform providers because, as we have seen, there are lots of plumbing code, and you can easily get lost, especially if different contributors use different way to think about APIs, about how to call them. So keeping the documentation is really important, especially for your customers. But a documentation without examples isn't really useful. And when we talk about the samples, we don't talk about writing one example and forget it, because for us, examples should be useful.
Useful, up to date.
Up to date. An example that is updated is worse than nothing.
Yeah.
And working. Obviously. And why that? Because we have seen that in our experience.
Oh yeah. And these users will always copy paste them, so take care about them.
And try to have examples that can be generalized by copy modifying pasting.
Yeah.
I mean, most of your customers are learning Terraform, and they are learning your API. They don't know your product as good as you, so they are going to begin by copy paste, modify, try to see. The best way to make people use your provider is be sure that the documentation is there and that the examples are as exhaustive as possible.
Okay.
Next one.
And obviously, test your documentation. You have a tool that allows you to preview in live your documentation, so you need to test it, yeah.
Use it, yeah, please.
Oh, yeah.
Make tests, not only unit tests, but acceptance tests. And what is exactly an acceptance test?
When you create a provider, it's the only way to test the code and to test that your provider is doing things that you didn't define to.
And it works directly on the API, saying that the provider behaves as it should.
Yeah.
So writing acceptance test is not optional, please.
No.
Next one
is
trying to keep your JSON structures in your API and the schema in your provider as simple as possible. If your JSON structures have a lot of branches and sub-branches, your Go code is going to be more complex, not difficult, but complex, more difficult to read, more difficult to maintain. So keep your API as simple as possible. It will make things, and that's especially important for the next one, too.
Yes, because provider need to be a simple reflection of your API. Need to be.
And the API is the source of truth. Of course, you need to debug. You have logs.
So you can add some logs in your code, and through the environment of Firebot, the TFlog, you can see them.
Timeouts and retry.
Yes. Through the timeout, a user can control all the timeout he wants, depending on the resource. It's cool.
For example, before we had a timeout because we had prepared it short and the Wi-Fi here hurt us.
Yeah, it's cool. I like it. And read the code of the other providers.
And especially big providers with many users. You will see that most of them has converged to an opinionated way to write providers. Try to keep it as close as possible. Try to talk to your contributors to try to get them converse with the same way to create them.
And you like the three periods, practice, practice, and practice.
Well, we have almost finished.
Yeah.
One more thing, or two.
Or two.
First, you want to have a nice cheat sheet about Terraform. You have this one. It is made by Aurélie, and it is really complete, and we have found really useful.
Yeah, thank you. And write a gift.
You want to test our public cloud. We have some nice vouchers, so you can get also the QR code in the other in our booth.
Yeah,
and then,
yeah, sure.
So I think we have finished.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much.
My mobile just died, but I think I remember the questions. My mobile just died. Yeah, let me. So there was like, yeah. Any advices for whenever there's no way to import? So I've done things like crazy, like editing the Terraform state. Like, what advice would you recommend if there's any for, like, you know, when you are using a provider, there's no import, and then how do you take existing resources, things like that, if you have?
Sorry.
Yeah. So imagine you are using Terraform to manage an API.
Okay, we are using Terraform to manage an API.
Yeah. Then there are resources.
Yeah.
And there's no import implemented.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice aside from editing the JSON file or something like that?
So you can use data sources in order to retrieve them. Mm-hmm. And the best solution is to use Terraform import to add.
Yeah. But sometimes it's not available. Yeah. There's no easy way, as far as I know. Then there was another around, and we discussed that when we were talking about the talks. What about using these principles, but instead of using Terraform, using alternative things, like maybe writing an Ansible module, maybe writing a Kubernetes operator? What is your take on that?
Last week, I did a similar talk to this one in Italy about Kubernetes operator. And it is the same way of thinking. It was also in Go. Some part of the code was even the same. Yeah. The beauty of this approach, it works with Terraform, but with Ansible, okay, it is wholly different, the plumbing, but it is the same thing.
Yeah.
Wrapping your APIs in the automation tools to make your users able to automate them, of course. And for me, it depends of the level of your API, but in an ideal world, hey, you can have a Terraform provider and you can have a Kubernetes operator. The overhead of having both of them isn't so big.
And any specific things to consider if you can change the API so that it's more Terraform friendly, in a way? I guess being RESTful is one thing.
RESTful APIs with sample structures, what we said.
You said that.
But for me, especially RESTful APIs, respecting the CRUD paradigm.
Yep. And I think that covered most of them, but if there's any other questions from the audience, because my battery died. Sorry about that.
I think everybody wants to go lunch.
Once again, in name of everyone, excellent talk, very inspiring.
Thank you.
So thanks for being here, and it's been a pleasure.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks.